Finch and Michael Williams. If I could get those four to come up here so we can go over some of the debate ins and outs, that would be great. Thank you. We'll get started soon. What they stand for, who they are, and that way when you go into the ballot, you have an education on whom to vote. So I'm excited to have you all here. My name is Sherry Gilligan, and before we get any farther afield, I want to open the floor up to Dan Coleman. Dan will lead us in a prayer, and he will also lead us in the pledge to the flag. So if everyone would rise while Dan says the prayer, and then leads us.
Lord, thank you for gathering us here today to join in this debate. We know that our representatives in America are subject to you, the Constitution, and those who elect them, the people. Let our elected officials not serve with their own interests in mind, but the interests of the people. Let us all understand that the budgets and money our elected officials oversee are not their own, as the government has no wealth of its own. It is the people's wealth, and the people's wealth is God's. and we are all merely stewards. Let us remember that authority rests on you, the individual, and the family at the center. Let us make our laws with freedom and liberty in mind, and let our legislators remember that it is often more valuable to eliminate bad laws than to create new ones. Let those who judge do so with the idea of equal justice, humanity, and the Constitution at the core of their decisions. Lord, we the people are accountable for the politicians we elect. Let us always be vigilant to defend the principles of the Republic, a gift from God. Let us recognize the sacrifice, commitment, and leadership of those who serve us, not for personal gain, but for service to God and his people. We ask this all in the name of God the Almighty. Amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, and please be seated. Again, I am excited to see all of the faces in the room. Some of the faces in the room I recognize as being elected officials, I believe. Do we have any elected officials currently in the room? No, just people, yes, in the back. Please stand up. Is that Kevin? I can't. And I'm sorry, I'm drawing a blank. I want to say it's Kevin, but it's not.
No.
Greg Allen, our clerk of court. I am so sorry. I put you in Kevin Tanner, and I don't know why. You don't even look alike. Sometimes the brain doesn't work, guys. Any other elected? Oh, I see Jim Boff, one of our commissioners. Any other elected officials? Over here, Dwayne's Point. Oh, Don, I go Paul. Current Solicitor General. Yes, she's standing there. I can't see her. Thank you, Dwayne. Any other officials? I see Brad Wilkins, Chairman of the Passaic County GOP. I see Trilby Leach, who is the co-chairman of the Passaic County Tea Party Patriot Alliance. From the state GOP, there he is. So, state GOP. Any other candidate who will not be speaking tonight from this area? Any other candidate want to stand up and give us a hand wave? Oh yes, Richard Woods. I'm sorry, Richard Woods, running for state school superintendent. Do you have like a 2-minute spiel? You want to come up here and introduce yourself and get the people to know you? Like I said, running for state school superintendent. That was a seat vacated when John Barge decided to run for governor. There are only like 1,002 people running for this position, so this is one of them. Come around up here because it's hard to hear. Right? It's hard to hear. So maybe you can sit real close and be heard.
Can you hear me just like I'm talking right now? Okay, I'll use my teaching voice, my coaching voice, and I'll project real loud. But my name is Richard Woods. Again, I'm a candidate for state school superintendent. I was a candidate in 2010. I was actually Dr. Barge's opponent. If you went to the very bottom of the ballot, I was there. A little bit of background, I live in Tifton, Georgia, so I'm in the southern part of the state. 22 years of experience in public education, 14 years at the classroom, 8 years at administration. All of that is pre-K through 12th grade at the school level. Also have some experience as a purchasing agent prior to getting into education. I'm currently a small business owner. Just a little bit about my platform or background. What I do say is common sense over common core. I think, you know, I was against it in 2010. I am still against it today. In Richard Woods' dream world, we would just do away with the Federal Department of Education and just put it where it belongs, back here in the state, but more importantly, back at a local level. I'm very classroom driven, and like I said, that is where our teachers teach, our kids learn, and you know where education takes place. Please check my website out at woodsforsuper.com. I'll, you know, leave some cards in the back. Unfortunately, my engagement takes me south where I cannot stay, you know, and talk because I have a wife that misses me terribly. See, I've been up here for several days now, but I must get back and attend some events tomorrow. So hopefully maybe in the future I get an opportunity to come back more formally, but I thank you for the opportunity. Thank you very much.
That will ever happen here. What I want to do, we had originally intended to start out with the Solicitor General debate and then end with the State Senate. However, though Jack Murphy had intended to come, he did send a statement. He is unable to be here, so we are going to start with a candidate forum with Michael Williams. As he's arriving, let me read. Can you hear me if I yell? Let me read what Jack had to say. To me, he said, "Thank you, Sherry, for the invitation. Unfortunately, my official duties during the legislative session prevent me from attending. We face many important issues in our community and our state. The recent snow and ice have compressed our schedule, making our work even more intense. I am working hard to fight Obamacare and its expansion in Georgia. As an early supporter of the fair tax, I am working hard to implement it in Georgia and reducing and eventually eliminating the state income tax. As a veteran and someone who has earned an A+ rating, someone who has earned an A+ rating from the NRA, I am fully committed to supporting our veterans and protecting our Second Amendment rights and the right to bear arms." So that was from Jack Murphy. He did ask a question of the candidate. Since he will not be rebutted, I did not give him the opportunity in his statement to ask a direct question because there would be no way to rebut it. I did not think that was a fair thing. So I ended before he did. That's just the way I am. It's not a democracy. We're a republic. Don't you love it? All right, so Michael Williams is the candidate who is here tonight, hoping to earn your vote to represent
27?
State Senate District 27, which covers the entirety of Forsyth County. So if you live in Forsyth County, this is one of the people. Jack Murphy in the paper is the other, who has said that he is running for state senate. So he, if you live in Forsyth County, this is a person hoping to get your paycheck. Your taxes, his paycheck. So please pay attention to Michael Williams. Oh, I'm sorry, I promised to leave. Dwight will kill me because I forgot to do this. We are trying to get more involved with Twitter. So if you have your smartphone, your smart device of any kind on Twitter, use the hashtag F, as in Frank, CTP, you know, Forsyth County Tea Party. So use our initials, FCTP. We will follow the conversation. So Twitter, hashtag FCTP. Thank you very much.
All right, well, thank you, Sherry, and also thank you for the Forsyth County Tea Party for putting on this forum debate, I guess whatever you want to call it, me up here. I also want to thank my wife and my son, Eamon, for joining me today. My wife has been a very big supporter of mine, and she's been there beside me the whole way, so thank you, sweetheart. I also want to thank all of you for being here tonight as well. I know there's a lot of better places you could probably be than listening to the four of us. I'd like to just kind of start out tonight by sharing a quick story. Happened back when I was in high school. I feel like it kind of describes the kind of person and the kind of character that I have. One is, I went to a very small school. There was only 20 people in my graduating class, and I'm a larger kid, and I was asked to participate in pretty much all the sports the school did, even though I kind of sucked at most of them. They asked me to run the 300-meter hurdle on their track team. Now, our school, again, was really small, and we only had three hurdles for me to practice with. So I'd go out and I'd do the conditioning and all that, and then I'd get my three hurdles, I'd line them up, and I'd practice my running and my jumping. And I kind of do a lopsided circle. I'd run my three hurdles, turn around, and then run my three hurdles. Well, whenever I got to my first track meet, I was a little excited, a little nervous, but I saw something I'd never seen before in my life. It was eight hurdles in a row. So the gun went off, and I ran as fast as I could, and I did the first three hurdles fine, no problem whatsoever. I was neck and neck with my competitors. That fourth hurdle, though, caused me a little bit of problem. My left foot caught the very top of the hurdle, and I fell flat on my face. I was a little embarrassed, a little hurt, but I got up and ran, trying to catch up to everybody. The fifth hurdle, kind of the same thing. I knocked it over. Same thing with the sixth hurdle and the seventh hurdle. By the time I get to the eighth hurdle, everybody had finished. They're going through their cool down, and I just wanted to kind of get off the track. But I went ahead and I jumped that eighth hurdle, barely cleared, but yeah, I knocked it down again, and I finished that race. That's also kind of been the story of my life. I've had all kinds of hurdles and obstacles that I've had to overcome. Some have knocked me down flat on my face. Others I've kind of cleared pretty easily. But the most important part is I get up and I finish the race every single time. And I feel like that today what we need from our elected officials are those officials that are going to lead us through some of the hurdles and the challenges that we face today as a nation, as a state. As most of you know, we have some very big and even dangerous hurdles out there. And we need more from our elected officials than just mere rhetoric or broken and empty promises. We need somebody that's going to get out there, that's going to lead by example. And that's something that I promise to do for you guys if I'm lucky enough to earn your guys' votes, go out there and lead. So thank you.
All right, thank you very much, Michael. Well, you know, originally this was going to be a debate, and we had questions that we would pose to both candidates. But since we just have Michael here, we're going to give him an opportunity to answer the questions that we have here. The format is that he will have 2 minutes to answer, and since we won't really have a rebuttal, then we'll just move on. So we'll get started. One last thing. Nydia Tisdale here is recording this, and this will be on YouTube in a couple of days, I believe. Yeah. So just an FYI, you can look out for a replay, right? All right. So, Michael, with the first question here, what are your four top priorities for the 2015-2016 sessions?
Well, the biggest priority that I have is to reduce the size and scope of our government. I really appreciated Dan's prayer whenever he mentioned that it's better to eliminate bad laws than to create new laws. That's one thing that I plan to do is to go down there and to look at the laws that we currently have on our books and try to get rid of as many as we can. That's one of them. Also, tax reform. I'm a CPA by trade, and I don't know anybody that agrees with the way that we're currently taxed. I'd love to see a fair tax put in place, as well as to do something with our corporate taxes. We have some of the highest corporate tax rates in the Southeast, and there's also several states around Florida, Texas, Tennessee that have a no income tax, so it puts us at a disadvantage when we're trying to go out and recruit businesses. Also, ethics. The stateintegrity.org website graded the state of Georgia with a grade of F when it comes to Georgia's corruption risk. There's several things that we can do to improve ethics within our political environment. One of those is simply submitting bank statements with our financial disclosures. Again, I'm a CPA, I've done several audits, and when December 31st rolled around and I had to submit my financial disclosures, I had all my stuff ready, had my bank statements, and I went to submit, and they said, Michael, we don't need your bank statements. I'm like, what do you mean? How do you look at my stuff if you don't have my bank statements? Well, you're supposed to trust your politicians. I don't really know about that very much, but I feel like we need to submit bank statements when it comes to our financial disclosures. And then also, some of that that's kind of just personal to me is to make sure that we have Georgia laws only within the state of Georgia. I know there's a lot of work out there trying to allow foreign laws into our courts, and I don't think that's something that we need within the state of Georgia to make sure that we just keep Georgia laws within the state of Georgia.
All right, thank you, Michael. All that talk about finances reminds me, I neglected to mention your support. This helps us keep things running. We don't have to pay rent here, but typically we meet at the senior center, so we have rent payments that we have to pay there and other expenses. So any donation would be greatly appreciated. All right, Michael. Second question here. Would you support establishing a ballot initiative or a straw poll regarding term limits for local, county, and state elected and appointed officials?
Most definitely I would. One thing, I am not a career politician. I don't feel like our founding fathers intended there to be career politicians, nor do I think it's good for government. So I would definitely support a ballot for term limits.
Okay, thank you. Have you supported the acceptance of the Common Core curriculum? If so, why or why not?
I do not support Common Core. Frankly, I feel like our teachers, our parents, and ourselves, that we can teach our children a lot better than bureaucrats and DC can. I have three children that currently attend Forsyth County schools, in fifth grade, eighth grade, and 10th grade. And I have sat in front of several teachers and administrators and talk to them about my children. And the commitment and the love and the dedication they have for my children, I think is head and shoulders above any place else. So to take that away from you know, local control, I cannot agree with that at all.
All right, thank you. In the interest of government for the people, of the people, and by the people, will you work to eliminate the Senate PAC fund that is spent on incumbents only? And why or why not?
As we all know, incumbents have a huge advantage whenever it comes to campaigns and being reelected. One of those is an advantage, the money that they have. Yes, I would definitely do what I could to eliminate that PAC. I feel like there needs to be a level playing field for all those that want to run for public office, and just because you're an incumbent doesn't give you the right to win, you know, every election because of financing.
Okay. Number five. How can we get the people to believe that the Georgia legislature is truly transparent, neutral, and carrying out the responsibility the state constitution bestows on the legislature?
So can you repeat that one more time?
How can we get the people to believe that the Georgia legislature is truly transparent and neutral when carrying out the responsibility the state constitution bestows on the legislature?
I once heard a candidate say that the biggest deficit this country faces is a deficit of trust between the elected officials and their constituents. I agree with that wholeheartedly. I feel like, again, I mentioned ethics. For us, for the candidates and also for elected officials, to be more transparent and where we get our financing from and things that we do, I think that goes a long way. Also, when I talk about leading, one of the things that I feel is very important is for our elected officials to be able to come back here and talk to us about what's really going on under the Gold Dome and the state legislature. I think about T-SPLOST and the epic failure that was. It was turned down by most of the state, but I think the biggest failure we had was that our elected officials didn't come before us and tell us why that money was needed, what it was going to be used for, and how it was going to be spent. Again, it was an opportunity for somebody to step up and to lead. So I think just us coming before you, having open and honest discussions about what's really going on, as well as being just transparent.
Okay. Are there any rules that come to mind that you think could be changed to provide more transparency or oversight?
Again, where the money comes from. You know, you follow the money, then you'll figure out who is actually making the laws and supporting the candidates. I've had an opportunity to look through several financial disclosures, and I'm not going to name any names, but there's one particular candidate where the vast majority of his money comes from is from out of state and even out of the county. So being able to track the money, see where the money comes from, I think is a large part of it. And then just, again, for the candidates and for the elected officials, to be honest and be open with their constituents and what's really going on.
Thank you. In the interest of protecting our children and educators and staff, what solutions will you support to ensure that there isn't a repeat of the issues surrounding the January 28th event, snow event, that many metro school systems experience?
I kind of have a different opinion of what caused the snow event. I don't necessarily blame the governor or the mayor. One thing that I feel is kind of needed in our society is accountability. We all decide to listen to the weatherman. From my everything that I read, it was only going to be some slight flurries, and when we all realized that wasn't the case, we all hit the roads and tried to get home. So as far as that event, I just think it was a fluke, primarily due to weathermen not being able to predict the weather. But kind of segue into that, I think that really showed the flaws and the lacking that we have in our road systems. That traffic jam, whether ice or not, would have been there, it just wouldn't have been as exacerbated with the ice. So it really showed a weakness in what we need to do with improving our road system.
It appears that the Speaker, President of the Senate position, wields a tremendous amount of power that sometimes might be construed as really not for, by, and of the people. Can you comment on this perception and how it might be eliminated?
My understanding is that that position is able to control what leaves committees. Before a bill can actually get on the floor, that person has to approve it. And I do not believe that any one person should have that amount of control. So I think taking away that ability would go a long way to eliminating that perception and that reality.
What are your conservative credentials, and can you expound on those?
What are my conservative credentials? Well, one, I am a small business owner. I'm a CPA, and those kind of things kind of go hand in hand with conservatism. I am a Christian. I've been a Christian my entire life. I have some of the basic fundamentals. I'm pro-life. I believe that the sanctity of life and that needs to be protected. Credentials, I don't really know how somebody can have credentials for conservatism. It's something that you either do or you don't do. It comes from your heart. And those people that know me, and as I'm out able to meet with most of you, I think you'll be able to see that and be able to tell for yourself, as opposed to me just standing up here and telling you why I'm a conservative.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, you're probably right on the credential. All right, what does the United States Constitution mean to you as you contemplate pushing forward on the legislative agenda?
What does the Constitution mean to me, and do I plan on pushing forward?
No, as you contemplate how you push forward the legislative agenda.
Oh, okay. I believe that our Constitution was inspired by God. I do not feel like mere men could come up with such a document. It means that the world to me, and our liberties, our lives, our children's liberties and life is based upon that document. And I feel like me personally, as well as all of us, need to do everything we can to protect the integrity of that document as it was written, not as it's being interpreted today. And I would do everything I could to protect that as part of my legislative agenda.
Okay, thank you. Unfortunately, we continue to experience increased rolls in the EBT and similar programs throughout the country. What can the state of Georgia do to determine that participants are truly in need?
Well, I guess to kind of step aside from that a little bit, the entitlement programs that we have, I feel like that is a humongous drain on our society, not only from a financial standpoint, but also from a human capital standpoint. So much money and time is wasted on these programs. As far as what the state of Georgia can do, I know right now there is a bill that's being looked at. I believe it's House Bill 772 that requires anybody that's on food stamps or welfare to be tested for illegal drugs. I feel like that's a step in the right direction. If you have to be drug-free to work for the government, you should be drug-free to accept funds from the government. So making more people accountable. Thank you. Yeah. Hey, I'm gonna stop that.
That's not true. That's good, leave one more. All right. There's been discussion of adding one or two incorporated cities in the county. What are your thoughts on adding these cities?
My thoughts are that local control is the best control. In every sense of the word, whether it's local government, your local school boards, and if there's a group of people that feel like they're not being represented by their government, they have every right to seek that out. I know there's different talks about there being one central, you know, coming Forsyth County government instead of having a bunch of small ones. As long as the people of Forsyth County agree to that or the other one, it really doesn't matter to me, as long as we have local control and the people feel like here in Forsyth County that they're represented with that control.
All right, and the final question. Currently, there are 7 states with no income tax, including our bordering states of Tennessee and Florida. Do you believe that Georgia should either reform or end its income tax?
I believe they should end their income tax. It's something that needs to be done for us to become competitive with businesses to attract and keep those businesses here and within the state of Georgia. It's something that we need to do as far as on a income, personal income, as well as corporate tax. We need to change our corporate tax structure as well. I was actually looking at a map today, and the state of Georgia has one of the highest individual and corporate income tax rates in the surrounding areas. So we definitely do something to keep Georgia competitive in the business environment.
All right, thank you, Michael. Those were the questions that we had. We do have a couple of minutes if you want to say anything in closing.
Sure. First of all, thank you. I hope I didn't bore you guys too much. I tried to keep my answers kind of short, distinct, and to the point. I know we have 3 more candidates that can get up here and probably entertain you a little better than I can. But thank you for coming out. Thank you again to Forsyth County Tea Party for putting this on. Again, I just want to kind of close reminding everybody that I am not a career politician. Nor do I ever want to be. It's not something that I plan on having as my retirement to join the state senate. My brother is actually moving his family, his wife and his 2 kids, here to Forsyth County. And he and I have bought the rights to a new franchise concept here in the entire state. So I still have a lot of businesses to create, a lot of jobs to create. I just feel like now is an opportunity for me to throw my hat in the ring and to give back to this great community. As I've gotten involved, I've realized that just because you don't like politics doesn't mean you should be involved in politics. I have the time and the means now to do that. I look forward to the opportunity to serve you, and I ask for your support and for your vote, and thank you.
Over in the corner here, we have Margaret Gasper and her son. She records all of our meetings now. That way, if you are unable to attend or you have a question, you know you heard something at the meeting, but you can't remember what it was, go to the ForsythTeaParty.com website. She posts, I believe, all of our videos. Is that correct? Yes?
Yes.
So all of the videos from our meetings are there. It's a great website to get some information. Not just what's going on in our particular Tea Party. Like I said, Trilby Leach with her Tea Party group. So we share information. We put out the GOP meetings. So anything you need to know is going on in Forsyth County that might be of interest to you, check out our website. We may have something to direct you to the answers that you're looking for. All right, so now we have 3 Solicitor General candidates coming up. We already selected at random who would go first, who would go second, and who would go third in starting your opening comments. And so if Donna and Bill and Susan, I know you're all here because I saw you earlier, if y'all would all come forward and we'll get ready for them to give us some information on Solicitor General.
So it's Donna. Just a reminder, this is your water pencils. Thank you. When it's red, you are mute. If you need anything, let us know.
Okay.
Dan is over here.
Red
with,
is with you.
Yeah. It moves, but it's. You do not get to push that. I didn't realize that there was a mute on. Dan over here is our timekeeper, so if we need to move him, you know, we will, but hopefully you'll be able to look over here. Can you see Bill from your position? Can you see Bill?
Yes.
Okay. So he's our timekeeper. I forgot to introduce Joe MacArthur. He's our treasurer. He's the one who's also moderating for us tonight. Give him a hand. He's doing a great job for us.
So we're going to have opening statements, and then we'll reverse the order for closing statements. So based on the straws that you pull there, we'll have Donna first, and then Susan and Bill. And we'll give you 2 minutes each.
Starting now. Good evening. My name is Donna Gopal. I am the Solicitor General. I was appointed by Governor Deal in March of last year. And I'd like to thank the Forsyth County Tea Party for putting this on as well. I am the prosecutor. For those of you who don't know what the Solicitor General does, the Solicitor General is in charge of prosecuting all of the misdemeanor crimes in the county, where the District Attorney is in charge of prosecuting all of the felonies. The difference between a felony and a misdemeanor are those crimes that are punishable by 12 months in jail and a $1,000 fine. Sometimes the fines are more, depending on the crime. And a felony are things that are punishable by more than 12 months in jail and more than a $1,000 fine. So I'm in charge of prosecuting things from your speeding ticket or following too closely ticket to a possession of marijuana less than an ounce or a DUI, alcohol or drugs, to a theft by taking with a value of $1,500 or less. Those are the things that I'm responsible for prosecuting in the county. I am responsible for prosecuting in two state court courtrooms. Judge McClellan is our chief state court judge, and Judge Abernathy Maddox is our other state court judge. I'm also responsible for prosecuting in the magistrate court here as well. I'm also the only candidate here tonight who's in charge of participating in all of our new accountability courts and our DUI court accountability court, which is a wonderful program that is aimed at those who have multiple DUI offenses. And it helps rehabilitate them and have them go through counseling and therapy and drug testing and to pay fines and report to probation. And we have a very high percentage success rate and a very low recidivism rate. So the DUI court program is a wonderful thing. Also working with the brand new misdemeanor drug court program and the new soon to be starting mental health court program here in the county. I'm also the only Republican here who has cut the budget by $200,000 since I've been in office of March of last year. That's a savings of 13% to the taxpayers of Forsyth County. Also, since I've been Solicitor General, I've embraced the multi-million dollar calendaring system that the county bought over 3 years ago, and we're using it to its full potential. And that in turn has helped me cut the budget by $200,000.
Good evening, and thank you for this opportunity to speak to you. My name is Susan
Zerini.
Sorry. My name is Susan Zerini, and I'm the... No? Let's see now.
There we go.
My name is Susan Zerini, and I'm the Republican candidate for Forsyth County Solicitor General. The question I've been asked most since I've started my campaign is why I want to be solicitor. I have a vested interest in this community. Since 2006, when my husband and I chose Forsyth County to build our home and raise our family, I was a prosecutor for 13 years. My passion and love for prosecution throughout that 13 years is why I want to be Solicitor General. I am running for Solicitor General so I can use my 13 years of experience to keep this county safe for my family and all the citizens of this county. Make no mistake, ladies and gentlemen, I am the only candidate with 13 years prosecution experience. My opponents both combined don't even have half of the experience I have as a prosecutor. I am also the only candidate that has both felony and misdemeanor prosecution experience. Just to tell you a little bit about myself, I'm a graduate of St. John's University. I went to receive my Juris Doctorate from New England School of Law. I was a prosecutor in 2000 for the Brooklyn District Attorney's Office. I worked my way up there. In 2005, became a senior assistant district attorney. And eventually, I worked my way up to become bureau chief in the gang bureau. And there, I supervised felony trial assistants, investigative assistants, and support staff. In 2009, I joined the Cherokee County Solicitor's Office as an Assistant Solicitor General, and within 2 years, I became a Senior Assistant Solicitor General. And there, I was part of the team that created the first misdemeanor drug court in the state of Georgia. I also served as Assistant District Attorney in Pickens County. Today, I ask you for your support, your vote, and your prayer. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bill Finch. I'd like to thank Sherry and the rest of the Tea Party for inviting me to speak to you and let you know a little bit about me. I'll be asking you for your support later on, but before I ask you for your support, you'll probably want to know among the candidates here, who is invested in you before you start saying, who are you going to invest in? I moved here to Forsyth County in 1993 when they talked about Forsyth County exploding when there were 40,000 people here. So the perspective of exploding has changed somewhat over the past 20 years that I have lived here. I was a Fulton County police officer for 8 years, and that has helped shape some of my belief systems. I saw firsthand the dramatic effect that crime can have on people, especially victims. I have, after I moved up here, I became a prosecutor for Leslie Abernathy, who is now a judge in the state court of Forsyth County. After I prosecuted here in Forsyth County, I then became a defense lawyer. I'm a past president of the Forsyth County Criminal Defense Bar, where we moved to have the control over indigent defense taken away from the state and placed in the hands of the local people. I was the president at the time that was pushed through. And another thing that brought me here to Forsyth County was the education system that we have here in Forsyth County. It's flat out the best one in the state. My wife works in the school system. I have educated my children here. I have a daughter who is a sophomore at Tech, and my youngest daughter is a sophomore at North Forsyth. The other thing is that that shows that I'm invested in this community is that I've been with Brownsbridge Community Church for ever since they built it here. And I'm on the host team there. So thank you very much. I think I see a red card over there. Yeah.
All right, thank you. So we'll go through these questions. We'll go in the same order with the first three questions, and then I'll reverse the order to give everybody an opportunity to answer a question first. Before we get started, though, we do have t-shirts for sale in the back. Supporting us there. All right, so we'll start with Don. And so the format of this, we'll give you 2 minutes to answer and then a minute rebuttal for the other candidates. Question number one, what factors do you consider when you are preparing for a prosecution of a suspect?
The first thing the solicitor and I that I look at, and I train my 6 assistant solicitors to look at, is the criminal history of the defendant that's been charged, because we want to know if there is a history of substance abuse, a history of drug abuse, anything like that, and if they've had other DUIs or if they've had other issues on the roadways that I'm in charge of helping keep safe. So after looking at those, then we review the facts of the case very carefully. We go through the police report. After going through the police report, we then speak with the officer who made the arrest. Any other supplemental reports that are included in the police report, we speak with all other officers on scene. And then after that, we make our charging decisions based on the evidence that we know we can prove at trial, because as you all know, the burden for a criminal trial is beyond a reasonable doubt, and that is the highest burden that our legal system has. So we have to make sure that we have the facts and evidence to meet that burden. And so after reviewing the history, reviewing the facts, speaking with the officer, talking about the options, about whether or not we'll offer a defendant a plea deal to close the case out if they don't want to go to trial, or how we will prepare to go to trial. Those are the factors that I take into consideration when prosecuting the case. Also, we want to make sure that if you have a substance abuse issue or some sort of bad habits, that driving habits on the road, that those are addressed by education. So you would have to take, you know, substance abuse education classes and driving education classes. All of those things go into our consideration of how we're going to deal with the prosecution of that case.
All right, thank you. Susan?
I disagree with Ms. Gopal's assessment. Absolutely. The criminal history is so important, but you have to look at the facts of a case. I mean, you could have a first arrest that's so egregious, it doesn't matter what their prior history was. It's got to be based on the facts of the case in front of you. And don't get me wrong, I do agree with her that you have to look at that criminal history. But first and foremost are the facts of that case. And then from there, you might not, as prosecutors always say, and after 13 years in training other assistants, I always tell them, you know, everything isn't wrapped up in a bow. You have to be able to do further investigation and go further, because just because you get a case on the front end doesn't mean you can't develop that into something else. So first and foremost, you need to look at the facts of that case and you need to go through them and see what you got. The absolutely criminal history is going to take a play, because you do. You want to put the person into, if they do have a drug problem. Forsyth County now has misdemeanor drug court. The same drug court that they're following that I started in Cherokee County. And it is important. These alternative courts, I know some people are a little shy away from them. Well, you know, they're important. You can't prosecute every case. You can't try every case. But what you can do is use the experience to make sure that you're prosecuting the right ones. And even if a case is hard, it's not good enough to say, well, I may not be able to prove it. There are some cases like that, but you have to be able to fight and say, you know what, you got to make yourself be able to prove that case.
Thank you, Susan. Bill, and I'll repeat the question. I should have repeated it for you as well, Susan. But what factor do you consider when you're preparing for a prosecution of the suspect?
Thank you. I think the very first thing that you have to do is look and see whether or not you can prove the elements of the crime. Each crime has a set of elements that you have to be able to prove, each and every one of, beyond a reasonable doubt, before you can obtain a conviction against somebody. That's the very first thing I would do. The second would be to look at the relationship between the victim and the defendant. I don't think you can treat every single case the exact same way, because it could be that you have a domestic violence case where John and Mary have been married for 50 years, and he all of a sudden, to make his point, had touched her right above her elbow. Now, you need to know whether or not that's the first incident within 50 years of blissful marriage, or whether or not that same sort of thing happens week after week after week after week. And so I think that you need to know the relationship between the victim and the defendant, and whether or not the incidents have gone unreported before. And then lastly, I'd like to know whether or not I'm following the Constitution of the United States, because sometimes the state loses, but are you doing the correct thing? And so that would be always my guiding principle, is that you may be right, and you may be able to prove the case because it is a violation of the law, but am I doing right? And every single day I want to be able to look in the mirror and know I am being just and I am being right in front of my Maker.
Thank you, Bill. Does anybody want to use a minute to rebut any answers?
Well, if I could just use a little bit of that time. Both of the answers from the opponents here up on the stage echoed exactly what I said in my answer. You have to look at the criminal history, you have to look at the facts, and you have to decide whether or not the case can close out with a plea or it needs to go to trial. So I just like to reiterate that fact.
Second question, we'll start with Susan. Forsyth County once again is poised for some rapid growth in business and housing starts. With this positive news, there also come some challenges in potential crime growth. How should the Solicitor General prepare for all the things that might come with this type of growth?
The way you can prepare for that is bring experience back. I have been throughout my campaign the theme of how experience does matter. As a prosecutor for 13 years, both on a felony and misdemeanor level, I prosecuted in one of probably the largest DA's offices in the nation. The way you prepare for that is you have experience, you have training, you get those. Everyone has to start out somewhere, and I too was once a new assistant district attorney, a new assistant solicitor. But you need experience to be able to train them and to be able to, so they know what to do. You also need to utilize the sources you have out there. You need to have in your office, what I would propose to do right now, the way the solicitor's office stands, and this has standed apparently for years, there is no post-certified officer that works at the solicitor's office. Those investigators risk their life every day. Now, again, I know you'll hear a lot, well, it's only a misdemeanor. Does everybody realize domestic violence misdemeanors? They're always rampant. They were rampant in Cherokee County, too, because they happen. And they're serious. You have an investigator going out there that's not post-certified. They're not trained for that. And they can be. It's not like they have to. They can be trained. They go and get trained like any other officer does. Those are the things to prepare this county for that. Those are the things.
Okay, now I'll repeat the question. Forsyth County is once again poised for some rapid growth in business and housing. And with that positive news, there come some challenges in potential crime growth. How should the Solicitor General prepare for all the things that come with this kind of growth?
I think that any time that there is managed growth, it is a good thing. And so hopefully the growth that is coming this way will be of that kind. But any time that you have an influx of new people, you're going to have an influx of crime. That's just the nature of the business. And so what you would need to do when you see the influx of people, you need to know what are your resources and what are the criminal statistics. If your crime is increasing, then you need to go before the board, the commissioners, and ask for more money in order to deal with that. Now, I know that the appropriation of money, it always makes everybody just cringe up, but you have to be able to perform your duties. And if you don't have the support of your local government to prosecute those crimes that come with increased people, then you need to go before them and ask for the money. You would also always want to be ahead of the game in knowing where those statistics are taking you, because you don't want to be back behind and always trying to play catch up. So you want to be able to have the resources and the manpower necessary to keep up with the influx of people.
Thank you, Bill. Donna, Forsyth County once again is poised for some rapid growth in business and housing starts. With this positive news, there also comes some challenges and potential crime growth. How should the Solicitor General prepare for all the things that come with this type of growth?
We've already prepared for it. We already have a program in place at no extra cost to the taxpayers of Forsyth County. It is called the SWELL program, and it is a community prosecutor program, and it addresses these exact issues. Because we're having such rapid growth in the county, we have someone assigned in the office already, no extra money is being paid out, to address homeowners associations about problems that may arise to become crimes, so we can go ahead and head on address those problems and see if there's some way we can point these people in the right direction without it becoming a crime. That's true, we do not have any post-certified investigators, and that was the case with the prior Solicitor General, who was the solicitor for over 20 years, and that is something that I hope to change soon. But the SWELL program is there to deal with this exact thing. The southern part of the county has exploded in growth so much that I realized that two other counties had this community prosecutor program in place and knew that we could have the same thing here in Forsyth County to point people in the right direction when they didn't know who to call to address maybe golf cart issues in their subdivision or people who run stop signs in their subdivision. So I'm very proud to say we already have a program in place to deal with this very problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody want to use time to rebuttal?
Actually, I just have a quick question. This SWELL program that you call, who are the people that are running it? Do they have any training in it? I'm curious to know who is actually doing that.
The person that is in charge of the program is an assistant solicitor here for the county, for my office, and they do have training going out. My eventual goal is to hopefully get a prosecutor in maybe some of the sheriff's precincts and maybe be able to help with questions they may have about whatever issue may come up before them. But we already have someone on staff. No one is getting paid extra money. No extra resources are getting spent on this program, and this program is already in place. We've already gone to a couple of homeowners associations meetings to let the public know that we are there to point them in the right direction when these problems arise.
Thank you.
But I would like, I would like to address that just for one moment, because we're getting into issues there that revolve around crime suppression. And crime suppression rests with the local sheriff here, Dwayne Piper. And I don't think that the Solicitor General needs to be allocating resources to crime suppression. Those are separate departments with separate responsibilities. And that while somebody may already be on staff, that staff member is being paid and is not doing the other functions of an assistant solicitor general. So I think that we need to keep our crime suppression with the sheriff's department and not with the solicitor general's office.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right, the third question, Bill, we'll start with you. What are your top four priorities or initiatives for the next 4 years if you were elected to office?
Well, the very first thing that I'd want to know is, are the resources being allocated properly and whether or not you're saving money in prosecuting the crimes that fall within your jurisdiction? Now, some of that goes along with salaries, some of it goes along with paper and that, and envelopes and that sort of thing, but I think that what we really need to be doing is moving forward as our with the rest of society to where we are using less paper and start using more electronic means of communication, and hopefully we will be able to get in with the local defense bar and our clerk's office here and maybe start with e-filing. Because the e-filing works with the civil courts and it ought to be able to work just as well with the criminal courts. The second thing is whether or not my staff would be having a conviction rate that is extremely high. Now, you have to be able to trust your staff and able to enable them to do their jobs. First of all, you need to hire the right people. Then once you've hired the right people, you need to make sure that you're giving them the support necessary in order to determine whether or not a driving under the influence case should be prosecuted or not. And if those assistant solicitors are not learning the difference between a case that you can win and a case that you cannot win, then you either hired the wrong person to begin with, or your training needs to be looked at in order to determine whether or not, hey, am I getting the information that I need to get to my assistants in order to enable them to make those proper decisions. The next thing would be whether or not I'd like to make the discourse between the two sides in state court to be a little more cordial, because even though you are against, I'm on zero.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Don't you love soccer?
I got red carded.
All right, Susan, what are your top four priorities or initiatives for the next 4 years if you're elected to office?
My first initiative would be to bring back experience to that office. That doesn't mean you have to go into, no one's going to go in there and just clean house, get rid of anyone. But you want to make sure that people are getting educated and people are becoming good prosecutors. As Mr. Finch says, you have to make sure that they know how to try a case. And you can do that. And you can work with that. We need to get, and what I've seen throughout this campaign is, and my goal throughout this campaign is, I want the citizens to know what the Solicitor General does. Because no one knows how many people I've went out when I made my business card months ago that said, what is the solicitor? I want people to be educated so that they understand. I want to start a program to go out into the schools. My kids are 5 and 7, but the teenagers out there, they don't know what the consequences are. I want to get out to the schools and make sure and educate them and know. So we can utilize the programs that we have in place and make it better. Utilize the drug courts, utilize them to make sure that we're making people productive members of society, and those people are there. And the other ones, we need to, where they need to be. We need to prosecute them to the fullest extent of the law. And you need that experience to do that.
All right, thank you, Susan. Donna, what are your four top priorities or initiatives for the next 4 years if you're elected to office?
The most pressing things, all of my prosecutors are educated. They all went to law school and they all passed the Georgia State Bar. They all have the ability to try a case, and that's what we do in the solicitor's office. We try DUIs. If you've been arrested for driving under the influence of alcohol or driving under the influence of drugs, we're going to try your case because you're making it less safe for the citizens of Forsyth County on the road when there are DUI drivers on the road or there are batterers in people's homes. Three most important things that the solicitor's office prosecutes are DUI, drug, and alcohol cases, and domestic violence. In the past, these domestic violence cases were all sent to pretrial diversion. No record was created. I have stopped doing that, and that is a top priority. Domestic violence is a cycle of violence. Victims get caught up in this cycle of violence, and we try those cases now. They no longer go to pretrial diversion. That's something else that I've also started new that I'm going to continue to do if I'm elected to office. DUI, alcohol, or drugs, and a rampant use of marijuana. We are seeing a great increase in the use of marijuana, especially among young people, which is why this misdemeanor drug court is such a wonderful thing here in Forsyth County that Judge Abernathy Maddox is running. With DUI prescription drugs, those cases must be prosecuted. Now, DUI prescription drugs, sometimes those are not the easiest cases to win. But we're seeing a rapid increase of drivers taking hydrocodone and oxycodone and Suboxone and Benadryl and getting on the roads. And my priority is to try those cases and make sure that it doesn't happen again, and that when you're on your way home, that those drivers don't hit you or affect your family members or friends.
All right, thank you, Donna. Anybody want to take a minute for rebuttal?
Just a minute. Ms. Gopal, I see that you're very concerned about DV cases, which are extremely important. Could you explain why you got rid of the social worker? That a social worker is there to help the community, the domestic violence cases are so important, how could you get rid of that? And that is cutting your, that's cutting your budget, but you got rid of a crucial part that affects the citizens of this county.
The social worker that was on staff was not counseling our victims. She had a list of her own victims that she was counseling, and she was getting paid more than my attorneys get paid. And my victims were getting seen, but not in a timely, in a timely fashion. I contact victims who have been a victim of domestic violence, and those defendants have been arrested within 24 hours of that arrest to find out what kind of contact provisions we need to put on for those victims. Do they need to have no contact with that defendant? Do they need to have no violent contact with that defendant because there are children involved? We need somebody who does that all the time. And we have someone in the office who does that for less than the amount of money I was paying the social worker that was on staff, who was only getting to do that when she had time. She had a whole list of other clients that she was counseling. So that's why I let her go. She wasn't an efficient use of county money. And the person that I have on doing that and contacting victims within 24 hours of their batterer's arrest, contact those victims and we get that information out so the magistrate court judges know how to step on to protect victims.
All right, we'll move on to the next question.
I wanted an opportunity rebut the perception that's been put out by the Solicitor General now, and that is cases are not being sent to pretrial diversion. Well, that office still is sending cases over to what's called mediation over in the Ninth Judicial Circuit. And so victims are then meeting with a mediator with the alleged person who committed the crime in order to mediate. According to the statute, it is because they live with the person at the time, or ever lived with the person at the time, and that's the standard. That's what makes it domestic violence.
All right, thank you. We'll move on to the next question. Bill, we'll start with you again, reversing the order. What is your management style of working across the entities required to effectively operate the Solicitor General's office?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
What is your management style of working across the entities required to effectively operate the Solicitor General's office?
Are you referring to other entities within the county government?
No, I believe this is referring to entities within the office.
Well, I think the only entities are that you have lawyers and you have non-lawyers in your office. Excuse me. Do I have this thing correct now?
Yeah.
All right. Sorry. The entities in within the Solicitor General's office, I believe, are those people who are lawyers and those people who are non-lawyers. And my management style is, first of all, to hire good people and not just good lawyers. It's a requirement that you be a good lawyer, but I think you also need to be a good person because there is immense power that comes with prosecution, and a lot of evil can be done in the name of the state if you are not hiring good people. And one of the things that I would always stress to my staff is something that I learned in our church, and it has been a theme that has gone on for a couple of years now from Andy Stanley, and that is based on your past experiences and your current circumstances and your future hopes and dreams, what's the wise thing to do? And so I would always want the wise thing to do be my guiding principle in managing my staff. And I would also want to instill those three questions to ask before you ask what is the wise thing to do of my staff, so that they're always doing the wise thing, always doing the just thing, not just doing the legal thing.
Okay, thank you. Susan, the question's to you. What is your management style of working across the entities required to effectively operate the Solicitor General's office?
My management style is, and I think I've learned it throughout my career. When I was, when I first graduated law school, my management style is People work for you. When you're good to people, people are good to you. You want a working environment, you want a family. And that is true. I worked in the Cherokee County Solicitor's Office, and everybody had your back. Because my boss gave us the trust and gave us the ability to know that we were able to do, he believed in us. And when you hire people, that's what you have to do. You have to find people that you guys work well together, because you have to give them the trust. The solicitor can't be a micromanager, they can't be. They have to make their assistants grow and their support staff grow. But that type of environment is so crucial, because then people want to work for you. And in my career as a prosecutor, and prior to my career as a prosecutor, when I worked for a Fortune 500 company, when I dealt with people and I managed people, I got good results because I respected them. I respected their time and they respected me. Just like working with the police force, we have two totally different jobs. It extends outside the office, the management style. You have to work with the officers they have a job to do and we have a job to do. And like Mr. Finch said, they are two separate entities. But working together with them and showing that you support them, that's how you get a good office. And that's how you get people to work for you. Because you show them respect, they show you respect, and that experience, you bring that to the table, and you will find that you will get everybody working for you and with you and for this county.
All right, thank you. Don, to you, what is your management style when working across the entities required to effectively operate the Solicitor General's office?
Open communication. We are able to handle large volumes of defendants in a short amount of time. For example, because we work well together, traffic arraignment, when you get a ticket, there's a date at the bottom of your ticket that you have to come to court, right? So you come to court on that date, and it used to take all day in this very room, because there is no room big enough in the courthouse to hold 600 people. The fire marshal always shut us down. It used to take all day to get a traffic ticket taken care of. My team works together. The prosecutors work together. The admins work together. The investigators work together. We are able to get people through traffic arraignment in 2.5 to 3 hours. You don't have to miss 8 hours of work because we work together as a team, because we have open communication, because we are prepared when we come to court. Bonded arraignment is the same thing. Because we work together and we have open communication, we were able to separate out and have a separate DUI arraignment to see who is eligible to come into our accountability court for DUI court. Also, the same is true for the misdemeanor marijuana court. Because we work together, because we have open communication between the admins, the investigators, and the assistant solicitors, we are able to get people through this system in a much quicker fashion. You don't have to miss work, you don't have to lose pay, and you can get your court date or you can close your case out.
Thank you. Would anybody like to take a minute for rebuttal? All right, we'll move on. Susan, we'll start with you on this question. What is or should be the mission statement for the Forsyth County Solicitors General, and what strategies and tactics should be in place to ensure the mission is accomplished?
The mission of the solicitor's office, The mission of the solicitor's office and all prosecutors is to seek justice. Seeking justice, it is not, and I say this on my website, it's not about just putting people in jail, because as the solicitor general of this county, you have many, many jobs. You have many jobs. You have to make sure that you are tough on crime. I'm a no-nonsense prosecutor. I've been doing this for 13 years. I don't play games. And what I have found, and I have the defense bar in Cherokee County, they always respected me. And that's where I primarily practice here, because I was straightforward. There is no DUI. Here's the offer. And if you want to go to trial, you're more than welcome to go to trial. And that's your right. But you have to be you have to serve justice. That's what you have to do. Yes, you have to be harsh, and you have to be, but you always have to seek justice, whatever that may be. Because there may be times that you get a case that regardless, you sure, as a prosecutor, boy, I want to prosecute him. But if it's not fair and it wasn't just, or there was something wrong with the stop, well, then that's what we have to do. We have a higher standard as a prosecutor. As a defense counsel, you have one goal. That's your client. As a prosecutor, you have to seek justice. And that justice is for the entire community, not just one individual.
Okay, Donna, what is or should be the mission statement for the Forsyth County Solicitor General, and what strategy and tactics should be in place to ensure the mission is accomplished?
My goal as Solicitor General is to cooperate with all agencies to effectively prosecute cases while seeking justice for victims of crime, and this enables me to keep the community safe. Working together with the Sheriff's Office, working together with the victim advocates, working together with the victims of vehicular homicide of the second degree, we are able to find out what the victim's needs are and accomplish those goals of effective prosecution without wasting taxpayer money in a timely fashion. So when I got sworn in as Solicitor General, we had 8 pending vehicular homicide in the second degree cases. Some of those cases were open for 2 and 3 years, and we were able to close all of those out by January of this year, which I'm very proud of. And that goal of effectively prosecuting cases while seeking justice really did play a role in my being able to do that.
Thank you. Bill, what is or should be the mission statement for the Forsyth County Solicitor General, and what strategies and tactics should be in place to ensure the mission is accomplished?
Well, I think that the very first thing is that you would always want to make sure that you are doing right. That you are standing up for the victim in the cases. Sometimes there's not a victim. Sometimes it's a run in a red light and there's no victim in there. But when there is a victim, you want to be able to give a voice to that person because you're their lawyer and you're standing up and fighting against evil. You want to be able to give a voice to the voiceless and to give strength to the weak. But you also want to make sure that you are upholding the Constitution of the United States. A lot of times we hear that a case failed because of a technicality. Well, most of the time that technicality was a violation of the United States Constitution. And I don't view the Constitution as a technicality. It's the bedrock of our society here in the United States, and I'll never refer to it as a technicality. What I would do to ensure that mission statement succeeds would be to enlist the help of the sheriff and enlist the help of our city police department that's headed by Casey Tatum. You got to have the support of the law enforcement and able to make sure that prosecution works to its best.
Thank you, Bill. Does anybody want to use a minute of rebuttal? All right, we'll move on. So Donna, we'll start with you on this next question. Please help us understand all your conservative values and perspective to financial, social, and political history.
I knew I was gonna get this question. So, you know, voting and the way that you vote is a very personal and private thing. And I know it's been my opponent's main focus to point out that I voted in a Democratic primary for the last 2 elections. But let me just point this out. Like Governor Deal and like President Ronald Reagan and like Condoleezza Rice, the Democratic Party left me. But regardless of who you vote for in a primary, that has nothing to do with your job as the Solicitor General. And our conservative governor, Governor Nathan Deal, interviewed all 3 of us. Maybe you didn't know that. We were all 3 up for this position last year in January, all 3 of us. And he saw something in me, and it was probably the fact that I worked in the office for 3.5 years as an assistant solicitor and already knew what to do to make it more efficient to save taxpayer money. And I had the history here, I knew the defense bar here, I knew the deputies here, and I knew what it took to make the office more efficient. Thus, the reason I was able to cut the budget $200,000 in 1 year. I don't know what other elected official or appointed elected official has ever done that in this county or any other county. $200,000 in a year? And that was by eliminating unnecessary positions. That was by emailing discovery to defense attorneys, which enabled me to save a ton of money in toner and ink and paper and postage. That was how I was able to cut the budget $200,000. But what's important here is my actions as solicitor this year and 2 months that I've been in office have been demonstrated, and nobody else here can say that to you. I've cut the budget, I've shrunk the office by the unnecessary, taking out the unnecessary elements, and I've made it more efficient for the taxpayers while prosecuting misdemeanor cases and making the roads safe in this county for you.
Susan, the question to you, please help us understand all your conservative values and perspective to your financial, social, and political history.
My conservative values started at a very young age. I am a lifelong Republican because my family, my mother and father, were lifelong Republicans in a place from New York where there wasn't many of us. But what I learned from that is they stuck to their principles, regardless if they were the most popular or not. They could have probably gotten a lot further in politics if they went to Democrat, but they didn't. And that is important to me as a person. And as Ms. Gopal says, it doesn't matter. It does matter because it shows your strength and you standing up for what you believe in, whatever it is. That's what I think people miss. It's not the point of Republican, Democrat. It's being true to your values. Because that goes to the whole essence of being a prosecutor. You have to stand up every day and defend and fight for the victims and fight for the people and do the right thing. That goes back to your values. You can't switch depending on what day of the week it is. Well, I'd like to be something one day and the other day. It can't be convenient to you as a person. The law has to be convenient to the entire county. We have to uphold that law. That's my values. That's the values that I bring to this table, that I bring to this race. My lifelong values that I've stuck to, regardless when I came from a place that, yes, it was not easy being a Republican, but those are the values that I grew up with. So I do think it's important, ladies and gentlemen, because it goes to everything of what a prosecutor is, to stand up for what's right. And sometimes you do, you stand up for what's right, and you might not have the greatest outcome. But every night as a prosecutor, I put my head on the pillow and go to sleep knowing that I did the right thing because I always sought justice. It may be not what other people maybe wanted and they didn't like it, but I always stuck to my values no matter what happened.
Okay, Bill, please help us understand all your conservative values in perspective to your financial, social, and political history.
Right. Who we are and what we are as a person is shaped by our experiences throughout our lifetimes. My education ranks pretty high up on the list for me, mainly because my dad was a principal of a high school, my younger brother's a principal of a high school, my mom was an English teacher. I have a sister who's a professor over at the University of Georgia and another brother who teaches and coaches football. So education runs very strongly through my blood. And I think that what we need to be doing as prosecutors is not only bringing down the heavy hand of the law, but also to educate our people to make sure that they are not re-violating. I think that education goes a long way towards preventing people from committing more crimes. I don't think it's any secret that those people who are less educated are committing most of the crimes. And so I would push for an education component to each and every one of the sentences that I recommended to our judges. Next, another part that shaped me was my experiences as a law enforcement officer. Being in that patrol car and riding around in Fulton County, and I can still remember shaking to death on my very first stop. A lady had run a red light, and by the time I got up to her and was holding her insurance card, the end of the insurance card was bouncing up and down. I was so terrified. She in fact turned around and looked at me and said, "What's wrong with you?" Well, I was too embarrassed to write her a ticket and just told her, "Make sure you stop at that red light." I spent a lot of time, 8 years as a law enforcement officer. I saw very bad things done to people. I think that those people need to be given a voice. I've been on both the enforcement side and the prosecution and now defense work, and I think that that well-roundedness is what I would bring to the table.
Thank you. Does anybody want to use time for a rebuttal?
I have a short rebuttal. Regarding Mr. Finch's wish to make education a component of each sentence, that's already being done. All of the sentences that we recommend in state court and in magistrate court require a victim impact panel class. So you go and you learn what happens to victims when they are a victim of a DUI accident or a traffic accident. And there's also the teen victim impact class, which is an educational class that we put on most sentences for teenage drivers so they realize the dangers of texting and driving. And the risk reduction program is required of all DUIs. So that's already being done with sentences in state court now.
Anybody else?
Yes. What I was referring to in the education component is not some state-mandated course that the legislature makes you take. What I'm referring to is making sure that our people are becoming educated, that they then have to go to class if they are of school age, that they, if they do not have a degree already, then they must attend and complete school or always be in school while they are on probation, or in the alternative that they obtain a GED during that time period.
Yes,
and again, I think that it's great that Ms. Gopal is continuing that work, but what I want to make everybody understand, I was prosecutor in Cherokee County for 3.5 years. This is the status quo. This is what every agency does, what the assistant district attorney, what we did in Pickens County, what we did in Cherokee County. This is what a prosecutor does. Many of these programs and going out and doing defensive driving and things of that nature, that's status quo. There needs to be more. This county is getting bigger and bigger. We need to be more inventive and bring more things to the table, because all of these things, again, that's fine and well, but that's status quo. That's what every prosecutor's office around the nation, around this county, that's what they do.
All right, thank you. All right, Ed, we don't have time for any more questions. So what we're gonna do is have the closing comments, and we'll go in reverse order from the opening comments. So Bill, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. As I said in the beginning, I'll be asking that you invest in me as a candidate. And one of the things that I want you to do is to look at and see who is invested in this community, who's lived here the longest, who has been a member of this community for 20 years, who brings law enforcement experience to the table, who brings prosecution experience to the table, and who brings defense experience to the table. And I think that that well-roundedness brings a better and a unique perspective to the job that the Solicitor General would have. And I guess the guiding principle always would be, as a prosecutor, am I doing the right thing? Am I doing the just thing and not simply doing what is the legal thing? Thank you.
Susan?
Okay, I think I have What I'm asking everybody, what I've been asking everyone over the past 8 months, when I decided to run for this position, I have a vested interest in this community. I haven't lived here for 20 years, but I chose Forsyth County. My husband and I chose this county, not for a job, not for anything. We had each other and our six-week-year-old, and we chose this county. And what I'm asking you, and I'm asking everyone as I've been campaigning, is I want this county to make an educated decision. An educated decision on who do they feel is the best person for this job. Who's got the most experience? I have 13 years prosecution experience. And ladies and gentlemen, please make no mistake. Being a prosecutor is not like being a defense counsel. I do work like that now, so I have that well-rounded experience. I come from a family of law enforcement. I've been working with officers in all these different jurisdictions for 13 years. And that experience, that cannot be taken away and it cannot be overlooked. That's how we're gonna move this county to compensate for the growth. You need that experience. You need to have prosecutors that know what they're doing. Not a prosecutor making the second largest salary that's been an attorney for 18 months. We need to go in there and make sure that everything is in proportion. There is going to be new people, and that's no, of course, you're going to have prosecutors that are new, but you need to train them. But that's what we need to do. We need to bring experience back to that office to make sure that we can move forward and not live in the status quo. We need to advance. Thank you.
Again, for putting this debate on, but neither of the candidates here have the experience in Forsyth County State Court that I have. Neither of the candidates here on the platform have been prosecuting cases here from, Ms. Zerini has never prosecuted a case here. She applied to the district attorney's office and wasn't selected. She applied for the governor to be the solicitor general and she wasn't selected. Mr. Finch prosecuted cases here in the last century in 1998 when there was only one state court judge. I am currently prosecuting cases here. And we've cut the budget $200,000. We've implemented all of the accountability courts to make sure we don't have people reoffending. They're getting the kind of supervision and they're being held accountable. They're being tested on a regular basis in DUI court, in misdemeanor drug court, and the soon up and coming mental health court program. She touts her years of experience in New York, but she's never prosecuted here in Forsyth County. She lives here in Forsyth County because I prosecute cases here in Forsyth County, and I make it safe for you all to drive on the roads to work, to school, and to church. So traveling on the roads that I keep safe, I want to keep this county where we are, and I want to advance with the moving population. And to do that, I ask for your vote and your trust in me to be your solicitor general next year, or in May.
Thank you.
Hey guys, just stand up here for a moment. Everybody, give these candidates.
Thank you. I appreciate the invitation.
No, it is me for the color, because I don't.
Oh.
You're free. Oh, we
don't. Well, I don't want to cut into your budget.
Don't cut into our budget. We're passing the hat, the jar, and selling t-shirts. We're
okay. You still gotta go.
Before we leave, guys, sorry, love ya. Don't leave us yet. Just wanted to wrap up. I want to thank you all for coming out to the debate. I know it was fun to come out on a Monday night. It's fairly late for us. However, after this, we're going over to the Rooster's Cafe if you'd like to continue the conversation. Wings and beverages, you have to buy yourself. Also, next month, hello. Love you guys. If I could have your attention, I would appreciate it. We didn't finish yet. Love the debate, but don't discuss yet. In March 17th, we will be back at the Senior Center. We have the topic is being a woman in Georgia politics. Right now we already have confirmed Karen Handel and Nancy Jester to attend. So if you would like to find out what it's like to be a woman in Georgia politics, come talk to these ladies who know from experience what it's like. That's again on the 17th. That's St. Patty's Day is a good night to come out, and then we'll go have wings and beverages. Important. Everybody was talking about Common Core. Very important. There is a rebranding effort underway. If you do not want Common Core, no matter what it's called, a rose is still going to smell like a rose, even if it has a different name. Brooks Coleman is the chairman of the Education Committee in the House. Michael Dudgeon is District 25 rep. He's also a part of that and on that committee. These two gentlemen need to have their phones blowing up. You have a phone, you have a pen. Use them. Just a moment, an announcement from Cindy.
If y'all are available next Tuesday, we're having our second drug summit. It's a very informative meeting about drugs in Forsyth County. It will be at the Forsyth Conference Center at 7:30, and it's try to pass the word. It's a really good thing.
Okay, Tuesday
7:30, drug summit.
Please come to support. Thank you very much. God bless.
Do you want me to take those signs off?
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.